जयरामन महादेवन होल्स ए पीएचडी इन संस्कृत फ्रॉम यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ मद्रास गोल्ड मेडल एंड फर्स्ट रैंक बोथ इन
हेलो
पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट डिग्रीज ही अंडरवेंट ट्रेडिशनल गुरुकुल एजुकेशन इन वेदास एंड शास्त्रास इन वेद विज्ञान गुरुकुलम बेंगलुरु अंडर प्राचार्य कोटेमने रामचंद्र भट्ट सिंस 2010 ही हैज बीन वर्किंग इन रिसर्च डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ कृष्णाचार्य योग मंदिरम His work in the field of textual aspects of yoga involves editing, translating, and disseminating inputs from traditional Sanskrit literature on yoga. Thus far, he has published 14 books and 13 peer-reviewed journal articles on yoga and Sanskrit literature. He is also involved in developing immersive learning methods of yoga texts. Yogasya Bhasha, a four-part self-learning material on Sanskrit and yoga. Yoga Vaisharadi, a searchable web repository on classical texts of yoga, are a few of his noteworthy contributions in recent times. His workshops on Tantra Yukti, ancient Indian thesis text construction methodology, are well received. His love also lies in composing Sanskrit poetry on contemporary themes. His expertise in the field of yoga has been recognized and utilized by various academic and research organizations. By nominating him to various academic boards and councils, including the Traditional Knowledge Digital Library of CSIR, Government of India, where he is a task force member. Welcome, Dr. Jayaraman Mahadevan. He is one of the organizers of the conference also. Now he will present his talk.
Thank you very much, Nagaraji. I know, as you mentioned, as an organizer, I know the time has already there is a time crunch, but I hope I'll have the time to present my talk. So I'll right away move into my topic. Hope my screen is visible. So this is more of a paper which is connected intensely to the practice and also textual tradition. So can my screen be seen?
Yes.
Yeah. So the title of my paper is in the form of a question: why should yoga practitioners consult Hatha Yoga commentary lore? And to answer the question, I have more questions. So when we ask more questions, maybe this might lead to the answer to the primary question. These are the subsidiary questions which may lead to the primary question, answer to the primary questions. These questions are not mine. Most of the yoga practitioners, yoga teachers, yoga professionals who would have undergone the yoga teachers training program or degree or diploma, whatever training programs they would have undergone, they would have certainly studied fundamental yoga texts, basically Hatha Yoga Pradipika. The text would have been presented, the translation would be there, they would have undergone the study and would be closely connected with their practice, and they would have tried to connect the text with the practice. Now, when the text is studied only with the basic translation of it, then as I understand or as I have experienced, we will have more questions. For example, I'm presenting a few questions from asana, pranayama, kriyas, mudras and bandhas, which covers all aspects of yoga, basically Hatha Yoga. So, for example, I'm just presenting a few questions, specific questions. For example, in asana, when we look at Hatha Yoga Pradipika, there is the description of Dhanurasana, which is actually Akarna Dhanurasana. Are the instructions for Akarna Dhanurasana not confusing? Then, can the inputs on Paschimottanasana be more precise? Means, when I just mentioned, when we just look at the basic Hatha Yoga Pradipika text and its English translation. Then on pranayama, for example, in Hatha Yoga Pradipika, we see Sitkari practice is there. Are we missing something there? Just looking at the original text alone, source text alone. And actually then there is a verse in Hatha Yoga Pradipika pranayama chapter which says, Yuktam Yuktam Tejedvayam Yuktam Yuktam Chapurayet. Yuktam is translated as gradual. So gradual inhalation, gradual exhalation, gradual retention, what does that mean? And then with regard to kriyas, coming to the kriyas. So what is the meaning of slowly, shanaihi vastram graset? That's how it is mentioned in Hatha Yoga Pradipika. So what is the slowly swallowing of it? And then when we come to mudras, what is the meaning of the term mudra itself, because we see translations of the term mudra as a seal. So direct text and the translation, that's what we will get, seal. And is it really seal or something else? Then bandhas are also part of mudras, as we see in Hatha Yoga Pradipika. Then for example, if I on Mula Bandha, the description of the technique is given, but am I doing the Mula Bandha correctly? If that question arises, so how do I know? So these are the questions that a teacher, a trainee, will be undergoing. So when he just looks at the text and the translation and immediately goes to a practice session, so then where will be the answer to these questions? Of course, the teachers, the tradition will help. They will give the right kind of answers. But as this is a textual seminar, so basically focusing on text, of course, and also tradition. So the texts themselves have answers to these practical questions, means practice-oriented questions. Here comes the role of the commentary literature. So when I speak of commentary literature of Hatha Yoga Pradipika, all the Hatha Yoga texts, so many Hatha Yoga texts. Yesterday we spoke about Yoga Taravali having a very detailed commentary called Raja Yoga Tarala. Though the text itself is small, the commentary is very elaborate. And similarly, one such beautiful commentary to Hatha Yoga Pradipika is Jyotsna commentary by Brahmananda, dated to somewhere around 19th century. To all these practical questions that arise merely by looking at the text and the translation, we can find answers. I'm just presenting answers to these questions, these subsidiary questions, which will in turn answer the primary question, the utility of looking at the commentaries by the practitioners of Hatha Yoga. Now, taking up the first question, asanas, are the instructions for Akarna Dhanurasana, not confusing the verse on Hatha Yoga Pradipika, merely looking at the text, what does it say? Padangushthau tu panibhyam grihitva shravanavadhi dhanurakarshanam kuryat dhanurasana muchyate. We just translate this, what does it have? Taking hold of the toes with the hands and draw up to the ears as if drawing a bow. Now, what does this teach us? Or there is a lot of incomplete information in this text itself. The padangushthau panibhyam grihitva, hold both of the toes with the hands. Then, shravanavadi dhanurakarshanam kuryat, till the ears draw as if drawing a bow. Now, drawing what? 1 feet, 1 foot, or both the foot. So this information as such is not available in the text and the translation alone. So the Hatha Yoga Pradipika gives only this much. So whereas when we go into the commentary, the Hatha Yoga Pradipika Jyotsna commentary, we see the details given therein. Grihitangushtam ekam panim prasaritam kritva, grihitangushtam itaram panim karnapariyantam akunchitam kuryat ityarthaha. Stretch one hand that is holding the toe and draw the other hand that is holding the other toe till the ear. So while the text itself, source text, is not complete in describing, probably the Swatmarama who composed, who just wanted to give the hint about the verse as it was already in practice, but the commentary literature gives the details so that the practitioner himself gets all the practical details about this Akarna Dhanurasana. Then again, so thus the answer to one subsidiary question is seen from the commentary literature itself. Then, now let's come to the Paschimottanasana. Can the inputs be more precise? Now, what is the source text about Paschimottanasana in Hatha Yoga Pradipika? What do we have? Prasar yapadau bhuvidanda rupau dorbhyam padagrat vitajangrihitva janu parinyastalalata deshaha vasedidam paschimottanamahuhu. Again, the translation, what does it say? Extend the feet, both the feet, on the ground, straight like a stick, and by arms catch hold of the tip of the feet, place the forehead on the knee and stay. This is Paschimottana. Here again, lots of questions are there. Now, stretch the both the feet on the ground like a straight like a stick. Now, should the feet, both the feet which are outstretched, should they be together or should they be apart? the source text does not have an answer. And then by arms, catch hold of the tip of the feet. So then by arms means fingers. So what fingers, how to hold by the fingers, the tip, that is also not mentioned in the source text itself. And then what is the meaning of the tip of the padagra dvitayam? What is the meaning of the tip of the feet? So that information is also not given. So for this, again, when we go to the commentary, we see all the answers given. So the first question was, should the feet be apart? To that, the commentator says, dandakarau shlishta gulphau prasarya, means the ankles of the stretched leg should be joined. So at the ankle, both the feet should be joined, so that the feet should be together. That information comes from the commentary. And then we had the question, how to hold the feet? Then it says, dorbhyam akunchita tarjani bhyam. So having the index fingers crooked or like a hook shape, one has to hold. And then what is the tip of the feet which is mentioned here? So agrabhagau angushta pradesha yugmam. So the big toe is what is intended as the tip of the feet. So that also comes from the Hatha Yoga Pradipika Jyotsna. And also the commentator goes the extra mile and also explains that yatha janvadho bhagasya bhumehe utthanam nasyat tatha grihitva. He also further says, when the practitioner bends forward to place his forehead on the knee, the practitioner should ensure that the lower part of the knee should not raise above from the ground. So to such extent, the practical details or precision in details for a practitioner, which is very useful, comes from the commentary lore. And these are examples, couple of examples related to asana. Now moving to pranayama, let's look at the example of Sitkari. Now what is the verse on Sitkari? Sitkam kuryat tatha vaktre grane naiva virumbhikam. This is what the source text says. Make a sound seet in the mouth and exhale through the nostril. Now, so the inhale component is mentioned, and then the exhale component, the how of inhale is mentioned and the how of exhale is mentioned. But the Sitkari is part of a Ashtakumbhaka. So is there a hold component or not? This will be, should the breath be retained within after inhalation? That question will come. And so one, but the source text in itself does not clarify whether there is a hold component or retain component in that. So that is clarified by Hatha Yoga Pradipika, where he says, kumbhakatvat kumbhakastu anuktaha api sitkaryaha kumbhakatvadeva avagantavyaha. Though the retention of breath after inhalation is not stated, but being classified as a kumbhaka, retention component is also to be understood in Sitkari. So this apparent confusion whether or not classically practicing Sitkari has a retention component, that is preempted by the commentator and clarified, which is very useful for the practitioner. So this is one example on pranayama. And the next and more important example on pranayama, which is very critical and which is very important as to why practitioners should go to the commentary level of a text. It's not enough if they stay with the text and its translation. We see this very important verse on pranayama. We know that in pranayama, three basic components are very important: inhalation and exhalation and retention of the breath. So there, as a guideline, Swatmarama in Hatha Yoga Pradipika says, yuktam yuktam tyajet vayum, yuktam yuktam cha purayet, yuktam yuktam cha badhniyat, evam siddhim avapnuyat. So the word in red is very important here. So what is the translation? One should gradually exhale, gradually exhale the breath, and gradually inhale it, and one should also restrain it gradually. Thus is siddhi obtained. What do we understand by gradual inhalation, gradual exhalation, and gradual retention? The text and translation serve no purpose, but just hinting that it has to be done gradually. So only when we go to the commentary, we just unearth, this is a treasure of information and very critical information on vital inputs on inhalation, exhalation and holding of breath. Because yuktam in the context, as we see the commentary of Jyotsna, yuktam in the context of inhalation means different, something different. Yuktam in the context of exhalation means something different. And yuktam in the context of retaining the breath, something different, as we see from the commentary. Vayum pranam yuktam tyajet rechana kale shanai shanai reva rechayet na vegataha ityarthaha. So in exhalation, what is yuktam? Shanaihi shanaihi eva. Slow, the pace of it, what is conveyed through the word yuktam. One has to exhale only very slowly. That is the meaning of yuktam in the context of exhalation. Now, yuktam yuktam cha na alpam nadhikam cha puraye. Now, in the context of puraka, inhalation, what is the meaning of yuktam? Na alpam na adhikam, optimal quantity. So, not too much of stuffing oneself with air or not too little. So, you can see previously yuktam in the context of exhalation was the pace of breath. And here is the quantity in the context of inhalation. And then yuktam yuktancha badhniyat, in the context of holding the breath within, what is yuktam? Jalandhara bandhadi yuktam badhniyat, means holding the breath with the jalandhara, mula bandha and udyana bandha, is what is the meaning of the word yuktam in the context of holding the breath. So that these are very critical in the practice of pranayama. And all these, so mere gradual does not do any justice. The practitioner does not get any, virtually no input the practitioner gets by reading merely the text and translation. These very important inputs come only by consulting the commentaries. So we saw asana, we saw pranayama. Now we move into the kriyas, which are also again an important component of Hatha Yoga, because we are in the discussing this conference is about Hatha Yoga. So kriyas are very unique to Hatha Yoga. So here we come to one of the kriyas. I'm just taking samples. I'm not going presenting all the examples. There are so many innumerable examples towards the utility of studying the commentary. I'm just presenting one in each of the category of practices that come under the Hatha, especially focusing on the Hatha Yoga Pradipika and its commentary. So here we see in dhauti. Dhauti is a practice where a cloth is swallowed and then it is drawn out. Chaturangula vistaram hasta panchadashayatam guru padishta margena siktam vastram shanaihi graset unah pratyahare chaitad uditam dhauti karma tat. So here the translation you can see, slowly swallow a wet piece of cloth, four fingers broad and 15 spans long, according to the instructions of Guru, dry it out again. This process is called as dhauti. Now, slowly swallow. What is slowly swallowing? Yes, one should not rush in swallowing it. Does the word shanaihi mean only that? Do we have any other dimension or important precaution that we need to understand, which can be understood by exploring deeper into the term shanaihi? To this, we see again the commentator chipping in with a lot of practical insights. He says, shanaihi mandam mandam kinchit kinchit graset. Tritiya dine advitiya dine hastadvayam tritiya dine hastatrayam evam dinavridhya hastamatram adhikam graset. So the idea is, slowly of course means the pace of it. One should not gobble up all the cloth. And at the same time, slowly also means a lesser quantity. On the first day, one span of length of cloth has to be swallowed. And then on the second day, two spans. On the third day, three spans. So one should not rush to swallow all the 15 spans of cloth for this dhauti practice on the first day itself. So the very word shanaihi, as it indicates the pace, it also indicates the quantity also, as it is beautifully brought out. And one more additional input is, you can see in the text that you swallow graset punaha pratyahare, you swallow and then draw it out. Is there anything in between swallowing the cloth and drawing it out? The commentator says, nauli karmana udarastham samyak chalayitva, means after swallowing the cloth, not immediately one should draw out, one should practice the nauli, and only by that the very activity of swallowing the cloth will attain its purpose of collecting the impurities and bringing out, or else mere swallowing and bringing out does not complete the process of dhauti. And that critical input to make the dhauti practice more useful, or the right way of doing dhauti, comes only from the Jyotsna commentary to the verse. Then we move to the mudras. Only a couple of examples are there. I will wrap it up. So now to the mudras. After that, an example from bandhas, and then I will wrap up. Now mudra. What is the very meaning of the word mudra? We see in the, if you just Google, there was a discussion on the term Mahamudra. We saw that, in the internet also, we see Mahamudra is translated as great seal. Great seal or great walrus, we do not know. But does the word mudra really mean a seal when we consult the commentary? Because the translations should not be simplistic. So there should be certain value, or there will be value to the words that are used in Sanskrita. So does the word mudra merely means a seal? Then we see in the Hatha Yoga Pradipika Jyotsna commentary, Mahakleshadin kleshan maranadimscha doshan mudrayati shamayati iti mahamudra. So what is mudra? Mudra means that which shamayati, that which pacifies. So great seal will not be the right translation. Great pacifier will be the appropriate translation, which indicates the function and outcome of the very practice. So this sometimes the trivialization of terminologies of yoga can also be overcome by consulting the commentaries, and the function, how it, or the how of it, or where this particular practice works. So that is also brought out only when we consult the commentary, where the commentary says mudrayati shamayati iti mudra, that which pacifies great afflictions like death, etc., and ragadvesha, etc., that is mudra. So that depth of understanding for the practitioners, which is important to develop the satkara, shraddha in the practice. So that comes only by consulting the commentary. And then the final example, now from the Moolabandha. So for Moolabandha, we see the verse in Hatha Yoga Pradipika, adhastat kunchane nashu kantha sankochane krite madhye paschimatanena syat prano brahmanadigaha. So though there are other verses also which describe Moolabandha, the drawing up of the lower region, the Mooladhara region, especially the anus, so drawing it up, so that is Moolabandha. The text as such limits the description only to that. Whether or not I am doing this practice correctly or not, so how do we know? Of course, the teacher is there to guide, but at the same time, the text itself, means especially the commentary literature, which I consider is a record of a practitioner, especially this Jyotsna commentary, we see the commentator goes an extra mile and gives the right instruction to the last bit he gives, and helps the practitioner to ascertain whether he is practicing the Mahamudra rightly or not. So the commentary says, yadi, and see, if Moolabandha is not practiced properly, nana rogotpadakaha, lots of illnesses will manifest. The commentator additionally says, all this is not in the source text. It is the extra information that we gain from the Jyotsna commentary. So he says, what are the kinds of rogas that will manifest? Dhatukshayaha, vishtambhaha, agnimandyam, nadamandyam, गुटिका समूहाकारं अजस्येव पुरुषं स्यात् मूलबन्धः सम्यक् न ज्ञातः इति बोध्यम्. नौ ऐ एम प्रैक्टिसिंग मूलबन्ध. ऐ लर्न्ड फ्रॉम अ टीचर, ऐ लुक एट द टेक्स्ट एंड प्रैक्टिस, बट हाउ डू ऐ असर्टेन ऐ एम डूइंग मूलबन्ध राइटली और नॉट. सो द कमेंटेटर सेज, इफ देयर इज डिटेरियरेशन ऑफ धातुस, इफ देयर इज कॉन्स्टिपेशन, लेस एपिटाइट, डलनेस इन द फीसेस or like the small ball of the excreta of a goat, so if it resembles that, then one should understand that my practice of moolabandha is not right. Then how do I ascertain that my practice of moolabandha is right? I have learnt it from the teacher properly and I am doing it properly. Here also the commentator says dhatu pushtih samyak malashuddhih agni deeptih samyak nadabhivyaktih yadi syat मूलबंधः सम्यक् ज्ञातः. इफ देयर इज नरिशमेंट ऑफ धातुस, रस रक्त मांस मेदस, इफ ऑल दीस गेट नरिश्ड बाय द प्रैक्टिस ऑफ मूलबंध, गुड बाउल मूवमेंट, गुड एपिटाइट, नादा मैनिफेस्ट, देन दिस इंडिकेट्स दैट माय मूलबंध, माय प्रैक्टिस ऑफ मूलबंध इज करेक्ट. सो दस वी सी, आई एम जस्ट समराइजिंग व्हाट आई हैव प्रेजेंटेड, दैट based on the examples that I drew from asana, pranayama, kriya, mudra and bandha, we see for the practical utility for the practitioner of yoga, professional of yoga, teacher of yoga, in consulting the commentary lore on hatha yoga, like this jyotsna commentary, it avoids a lack of clarity, precision in inputs, as we saw in paschimottana, avoiding superficiality and bringing in depth of practical wisdom, be it the translation of the word yuktam as gradual or mudra as seal, that superficiality or simplistic translation, all those are avoided. And then bringing out unnoticed dimension and addition of essential component, for example in sitkari, the existing but not explicitly stated kumbhaka component was brought out, and then the quantity of cloth, so which was again not mentioned, was brought out, and then going an extra mile and presenting experiential wisdom. See, whatever was stated in the context of moolabandha is not textual or mere theoretical. One cannot simply by wish away the commentary literature as mere theoretical. It is experiential wisdom which is recorded. So more can be added. I have just given a few examples. So commentary literature is a mine of information for practitioners. As I mentioned, I just presented one commentary on one text about the utility of their commentary in various practices. Similarly, more commentaries on the same text like Hatha Yoga Pradipika and other commentaries on other Hatha Yoga texts also hold a mine or treasure house of information, practical information. And so by this, when we heed to the commentaries, then what happens? Injuries are avoided, adverse impact are avoided in the practice of yoga. Yoga injuries can be overcome. Trial and error can be avoided by practitioners with surety, confidence and certainty. They can go to the practice. And if the basics are clear by studying the text and the commentary, then what happens? As one practices, based on that, more deeper insights on practice, more practical wisdom can be added by the practitioner if the existing knowledge is absorbed in its fullness. And then as traditional offers practical wisdom, so the important point is, of course, this is a Hatha Yoga conference on text and tradition. Texts are generally taken as theoretical inputs, and tradition is taken as the living example for the practice of the text. But the idea that I highlighted through this paper is, texts are also manifestation of tradition only. Means the texts themselves hold many live information. Only the thing is, it has to be drawn out. And one has to have the patience to go to the text to unravel those very live information as is available in the living tradition. Now, I'm just concluding with the last two slides. So how do, as a yoga practitioner, as a yoga professional, as a yoga teacher, how do I go about accessing the commentaries? Only a few commentaries are translated, as presented by previously by Dr. Jason Birch or Professor Balasubramaniam also presented the work that is being done in Kuppuswamy Shastri Research Institute. Lot is being done and lot remains to be done. So many commentaries in Sanskrita are to be published. So as the researchers, textual people are working on this, yoga practitioners also can move towards the commentaries. Of course, it is the work of the job of the researchers to bring the text and commentary closer to the practitioner, but the onus is also on the practitioner to move towards the commentary. So we know yoga is a multi-directional, multi-dimensional discipline. Yogis do not have any reluctance in their practice, in their profession, to acquaint themselves with anatomy, physiology, Ayurvedic principles, psychology, etc. In the same way, there should be no shying away in equipping oneself with the wisdom of Sanskrita also. When one learns the Sanskrita language, it should be placed on par with equipping oneself with anatomy, physiology, Ayurveda, etc. Only then one can be privy to all this knowledge, which is there for us, left by our own forefathers to be discovered. Yogasya Bhasha, which is one effort that in Krishnamacharya Yoga Mandiram, we collaborated with Sanskrita Promotion Foundation, where we did a set of four self-paced books where yoga and Sanskrita can be learned together, aimed at the lay yoga practitioner and the yoga professional, and also those who are into the field of Sanskrita to get an authentic immersion into yoga. So both ways it works. So one can start going about it, equipping in Sanskrita by consulting this Yogasya Bhasha, which is there available in this link. And also to organizations and to institutions which are running courses on yoga. So textual immersions can be organized for the practitioners of yoga, which can be add-on courses to existing teachers training program. We at Krishnamacharya Yoga Mandiram, at the textual research department, we created, I worked on creating a textual immersion, especially on Hatha Yoga Pradipika, on Asana, Pranayama, Mudra and Bandhas, focused on taking the practitioner, or not limiting only to text and translation, leading the practitioner to the practical wisdom that is available from the commentary also. I'm very happy to share that we did one such textual immersion with Indica Yoga in the year 2019 on Hatha Yoga Pradipika on asanas. And based on that experience and experiment on teaching in a yoga with the commentaries in an immersive way, I also wrote a paper based on the experience imparting yoga texts in Sanskrita, a teaching experiment and its outcome. So this is there to be referred. I presented in the 17th World Sanskrit Conference. And so this can be replicated in various organizations so that it facilitates the movement of the practitioners towards till the commentary literature, not to merely remain at the level of mere text and translation. Because this is very important, because Vyasa in Yoga Sutra commentary, he says, yoga, of course, it's a practice, but swadhyaya is a very integral component of yoga. He says, swadhyaya yogamasita, yoga swadhyaya mamane, swadhyaya yoga sanyuktya paramatma prakashate. One has to nourish one's study with yoga and nourish yoga with study, means practice with learning. And learning should become more insightful with the experiential knowledge. So swadhyaya and yoga should go together. Only then the ultimate goal of Paramatma, realizing the Paramatman, which is the goal of yoga in general, be it Hatha Yoga or Raja Yoga, that will be attained. In that process, consulting, studying the commentary literature of Hatha Yoga especially plays a very critical role. I end my paper here. I thank the organizers for the opportunity.
Thank you very much, Jayaramanji. You have always been such an immense trendsetter, contributor, heartbreaker for yoga studies and yoga research. This is again another eye-opening aspect about commentaries, how commentaries are important. You have been doing this from a long time. how commentaries contribute to yoga studies has not been focused enough in other projects also, other projects in other countries also. They have not done enough focus on the importance of commentaries as independent texts. They are also texts in themselves. Always commentaries have been looked at as helpful in studying a text only. But how commentaries help in understanding the practice of yoga, and how commentaries themselves are contributions from the commentators to the science of yoga, to the tradition of yoga. This you have brought out very well, Dr. Jayaramanji. And one question from me would be, do these commentators also provide information about themselves, bio of themselves, so that we know the time of their commentary writing, and so that we from the commentaries also know the sequence of the development of ideas from the original text to the commentary?
Of course, means that's a challenge for people working in the field of manuscriptology, because certain commentators in certain manuscripts, we find the colophon information at the end. The Pushpika gives the information. Unfortunately, in certain occasions, we don't get it. But with regard to this Brahmananda commentary, this Jyotsna commentary from which most of my references came, certain biographical information are available, and he is one student of a Meru Shastri, and scholars are able to, based on those inputs, they are able to trace him to somewhere in the 19th century. So it all depends upon the manuscripts. So what information they hold. So yeah, that's how we get into it, sir.
So we were referring to the Yoga Bhasha Sanskrita. We are very keen to have a properly well-developed program based on that. So we'll be shortly working with you on that project. And we look forward to taking that to as many people as possible, because that's a very important component, equipping Sanskrit yoga teachers with Sanskrit. And that needs to be done in a way it can be scalable. So we look forward to that work with your collaboration.
Thank you very much. I will be very happy to collaborate and work together on this project.